I've been traveling for the last several months in Indonesia. I sense a new fervor amongst the Indonesian people. I sense a desire for change. I sense much more awareness of the problems of Indonesia. I think this is because of the digital revolution. Everybody has these gadgets, they're wired in, they know what's happening. The flow of information is very fast. I sense strong.
And have you changed? Is there any difference between Prabowo 2014 and 2019?
I think I try to hope that I've been a bit more wiser, perhaps, a bit more.
So, what are the lessons if you've had more?
A bit more, what do you call it, philosophical. That I see that what I have to do is my duty as an Indonesian citizen, my duty as an Indonesian leader, and I study history. I consider myself an amateur historian. I love history. I read, so I'm committed to democracy. A gentleman asked me what I think of democracy. I'm very honest that I sometimes despair of democracy in countries like Indonesia. Because I think democracy, there are certain requirements for a society to be able to carry out democracy well. First, you must have education. You must have literacy. And sad to say, the World Bank made an evaluation and said that Indonesians, 55% of my people are functionally illiterate. That's the considered opinion of the international experts. But anyway, I think was it Winston Churchill or somebody, some great statesman said that democracy is not a good form of government, but it's the least bad of all the others.
And we look at Indonesia, and we say actually, you know, it's the third most populous democracy in the world after India, after the United States. So it's an extraordinary exercise, democratic exercise that will be happening next year. But are you hinting that you're not entirely convinced that Indonesia is ready for democracy? If you say you need education,
I'm telling you how I see it, that the culture of cheating is very prevalent. And even now, there's a big debate now that the General Election Commission of Indonesia, with some of the parties, including my party, we are still struggling, we're still demanding to check an additional 31 million names. So, we have already agreed to 184 million names on the voter list, and all of a sudden the Ministry of the Interior of Indonesia sent another 31 million names. So we request to check these names, and this request has not yet been granted. So I think it's as basic as that, sir.
So
you say democracy, we talk about democracy. What's democracy? Democracy is fair elections. And what is fair elections? A clean voter list. You can't have 5 million ghost names.
And
that's what we have.
So it's imperfect. It's imperfect. But as you, in your Churchillian mode, saying it's the least bad, if you compare it with what went before, is it not better than what went before in
to be very frank, of course the rituals or the elements of free democracy is there, granted. If there is no democracy in Indonesia now, I will not be a chairman of the third largest party of Indonesia. So yes, for all its faults, we have achieved great things. There are elements in the Indonesian power elite that I think want to go back to the old days. They're thinking that they can, they can engineer election results, which I think is an aggression. I was a general, I was a member of the old order, of the new order of Suharto regime. But I was within the regime. I was always proposing for the military to leave politics. But now we see the sad developments of the some government institutions being dragged into politics.
But to go back to those days, in 1998, you were in charge of a unit which oversaw the crackdown on student activists, and you called them, I think at the time, traitors to the nation. But with hindsight, weren't they correct? Weren't they right? Weren't they arguing for democracy?
I don't know if you pick up a phrase from somewhere, I don't remember, saying that. I was a serving officer, and I did my duty, but as you know, many of those students who were against the military regime now are in my party, fighting for me to be the next president.
Okay, so if you are the next president, what changes in Indonesia? What does President Prabowo mean?
The most pressing demand of the situation, in my opinion, is to create a team of the best and brightest with the highest integrity of Indonesians, assemble this team and carry out reforms to produce a clean, non-corrupt government. The main issue in Indonesia is the rampant and massive corruption. In my opinion, it's already like a cancer has reached maybe stadium four.
So this is not a good competition to be in, but I mean, if you compare with other places in the region, you know, Malaysia's had a giant corruption scandal. Other parts of the world, South Africa, we've seen has huge problems and has changed government because of it. How would you place that problem on the spectrum in Indonesia? Are you among the champions?
I am inspired by what happened in Malaysia. I'm inspired by what happened in South Africa. So there can be peaceful reform. There can be peaceful change by the ballot box. And everybody always underestimate the Indonesian people and underestimate the Indonesian electorate. The Indonesian elite thinks that they can buy everything. Indonesians are poor, so we just give them a couple of sacks of rice and they'll vote for me. I'll buy everybody. I'll buy MPs. I'll buy political chairman. I'll buy governors. I just give them money. They support me. I'll buy electoral commission. Please change the results. This is the culture. But now I think what happened in Malaysia inspired us. So now, now I'm getting a lot of support by the mothers, by ordinary people. They're sending money to me, 20,000 rupiahs, 100,000 rupiahs. 20,000 rupiahs is like 20 Singapore cents, I think. $2, sorry. They sent $2. I just got today transferred $2. I think his name is Fazia, Iqbal Fazia. Sir, I can only send $2. But this is all I have, and I want to support you.
So if I were to give you, as sometimes that comparison has been used, Prabowo Trump, would you take that as a compliment or an insult?
I don't know, to be very frank. I'm not too versed in the dynamics of the US situation now. But what I understand is that he has alienated a lot of Americans, but he is aspiring to defend American interests. So in that sense, that I think we have to respect his commitment to defend American interests. You know, the way he does it, I cannot comment, right? The way he does it, his propensity to use the Twitter, you know, it confuses me also, right?
Do you use Twitter?
I do, but I'm very low-key. You know? I'm very low-key. Because in Indonesia, they have very strict laws. We can be arrested for tweeting something that's not politically correct.
Okay, be aware of that as you tweet tonight. We have an audience here with a lot of business people in it from Singapore. What would you say to them, and what they could expect if you were to be in charge? What would they see as different in the business context for Indonesia?
You know, my argument is for business people, because I've been in business also right now for 30 years. If I come to a country, you know, I was working for my brother. My brother was involved in countries like Kazakhstan, Azerbaijan, Sudan. So whenever I come to a country, what we want is, one, number one, stability. Number two, we want some sort of rule of law, assurance that we will get a fair treatment. Because we are involved, we put money into the country. We don't want to be blackmailed. We don't want to be extorted. We don't want to be treated unfairly. And my position is, if I am elected, my driving concern and my driving passion will be to create a rational, modern, democratic, and clean bureaucracy, clean government, and I think this is the best environment for business. Business people, we will not.
Are you saying you want Singapore and Indonesia? You're saying you like Singapore and Indonesia in the sense of...
I'm very open. I grew up in Singapore when I was a child. I grew up also in Malaysia. I think the early Singaporean leaders, Lee Kuan Yew and his cohort, his group, did a very good job. They cleaned up Singapore, and they have made Singapore into a success story. But what is the success story of Singapore? Clean government. Assurance of fair treatment. Assurance of the rule of law. That's why people feel comfortable in Singapore. Right? So, this is what I think Indonesia needs. We just have to get our act together. It's our challenge. It's the Indonesian elite that is, in my opinion, that is not coming up to the challenge. I think it's I openly say it's failure of the Indonesian elite that we have not achieved this clean meritocratic society. That's very essential for development, for economic progress.
So we have a few minutes left. Who would like to ask a question?
Hi, Julian Corbett from Sabaka, back here. I read that you had made a comment that Indonesians love music, and the reason why radical Islam would never win in Indonesia is that they don't. Is that a statement that you made?
Yes, I did. Basically,
And beyond the quip, I'd be interested to hear your view on, do you really believe that this is something that isn't going to radically affect Indonesia over the coming years? And what is your view on how you unite Indonesia around this message of anti-corruption that you're focusing on, when actually those are tensions that exist today in Indonesia?
Yes, I've been traveling the last months. I've been meeting many leaders from many groups, many especially Islamic groups. I am convinced that the core majority of Muslims in Indonesia are moderate and do not like to be dragged into radical politics. But once again, it's the responsibility of leaders to rise to the occasion. Leaders must lead, leaders must teach. And I'm still very optimistic because I see many Indonesian religious leaders denounce radicalism of any stripe. And basically the teachings of Islam enforces this. So I'm still convinced that good leadership can diffuse any move towards radicalism. But once again, if there is hopelessness, if there is frustration, if there is pessimism, if there's no future for the young, then, you know, these religious demagogues can come in and can influence, and they can give a nice message.
Is it in fact a trend that you detect in Indonesia, that there is a greater conservatism and a greater radicalism?
I would not say a greater radicalism, but I think there is at present a sense of frustration. A sense of we are being left behind. The outsiders, I think most of you here, when you see the figures of Indonesia, oh, Indonesia is doing well. 5% growth. You go to Jakarta, see all those nice buildings. But there's no trickle-down effect. There's no trickle-down effect to the people. So they see these beautiful cars go by, Lexus, BMW, and they look and they feel resentment, they feel jealousy. They also like to go in that BMW. And they see television, all these soap operas of rich Indonesians in beautiful houses, and they are in their shack. In Jakarta, 1 hour from the presidential palace, we have people in North Jakarta, Tanjung Priok, who do not have clean water. They have to buy clean water. Can you imagine? In my opinion, this is very, very worrying. So that's why I consider Indonesia now to be in a race against time. How we can provide basic services to the most number of Indonesians.
Yeah, one more question at the front, we're just about sneezing to the time before my virtual buzzer goes right at the front table here.
Thank you. Actually, Stephen Corcoran from Temasek. Wondered if you could share your views about the future of ASEAN. We've just had the ASEAN summit here. There's a great deal of questioning around multilateralism, particularly with a lot of populist leaders overseas that are suggesting that multilateralism doesn't have a role anymore. I'm wondering, can you share your thoughts on where multilateralism and ASEAN in particular is heading?
I would like to see ASEAN succeed because, as you know, there's such a thing as a safety in numbers. So if we cooperate closely, the 10 countries of Southeast Asia, we could be more respected. We could be more heard, our voice. But once again, in the end, each of these 10 countries must, each of the leaders of these 10 countries, each of the governments of these 10 countries must serve and look out for their people. And if these governments are inefficient, corrupt, cannot deliver basic services, then there will be no stability, there will be no peace, and therefore ASEAN becomes some sort of irrelevance to the internal dynamics of a country. So it's a very beautiful concept, it's good. We must try to make it happen, but once again, in the Indonesian context, it's the Indonesian leaders that must get our act together, our act. We must deliver good governance to the Indonesian people.
So we're out of time, but I want to make time to ask you for your predictions for 2019.
I want to be very frank, I'm not into predictions. But I will say my hopes. For Indonesia, I hope that we can emulate what happened in Malaysia and in South Africa. We can have peaceful change. The will of the people of Indonesia will be heard, and democracy will prove successful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.